So when you say vibe, I think it's all about you walk into a place and you yourself, as the promoter of the business, feel your imagination will work really well in this place. Mm-hmm. And then it's easy.
Got it.
But if you believe, or sorry, if you are confused yourself and you are so dependent on the interiors guy to give you the vibe, then it's a little difficult. That's where sometimes you may go wrong.
Brings me to ask you, define a good bartender. Who's a good bartender to you?
A good human being.
Hey guys, welcome to the Inside the Drinks Business episode. I'm here with Yangdup Lama, India's number one bartender, and we are sitting at his bar, Sidecar, which is India's number one, and I think just been awarded number 47, if I'm correct, in the world. Thank you for taking the time out.
Thanks, Sid.
Why don't you tell us, our audience, a little bit about yourself, you know, people who are sitting in US, UK, just what you've been doing in India.
You know, I've been in this business for 25 years. I came from a small little town in the eastern part of India called Darjeeling. And I came to Delhi 25 years ago. I started off as a hotelier at the Hyatt in Delhi. And I worked there at the bar, not really inside the bar, but on the floor, at the back. And that's how I started my journey here in Delhi, at the bar. And then after a couple of months, got to work behind the bar. And I've been in the bar business for 25 years now. You know, in the hotels, as a freelance bartender, managing events, weddings, consulting for bars and restaurants, the liquor industry, doing a little bit of trainings for hotels and other establishments, and then running this one, as well as another small little neighborhood speakeasy bar in Gurgaon, and that's what I do.
I see you're very close to your first child, right, speakeasy, and that's really more of an emotional play for you. So yes. walk us over your, what was the idea of starting that?
It was purely, you know, this actually happened 9 years ago. We are celebrating the 9th anniversary end of this month. And it purely happened from the fact that as a bartender, you always dream of having your own little bar, right? And one was definitely that. Second was on my off days, as you know, as a bartender, on my off days, whenever I wanted to visit a bar, I would never find the kind of bar that I would have a very strong sense of belongingness. Mm-hmm. I wanted to go to a bar that I could call mine. Mm-hmm. So me and my partner always felt that, you know, there is a great scope to create a nice neighborhood bar. Mm-hmm. Not really a nightclub or a lounge, mm-hmm. but something like a true bar. Mm-hmm. And that was the whole idea. And that, you know, made us actually create that particular bar. Mm-hmm. So what we did is we met a few investors. Mm-hmm. Everybody was always about scalable business. Mm-hmm. And, you know, mm-hmm. financial plans and stuff like that. We didn't have those plans. Mm-hmm. All that we knew is that we want to do a nice neighborhood mm-hmm. bar, mm-hmm. the bar that we thought would be
the after-work bar where people after work have exactly. a little beer and then they go home.
So it will just fizzle out. Yep. And then finally we decided in 2012, we had a little bit of money saved. So me and my partner said, okay, this is our savings. We'll go to wherever it fits into our scheme of things. And we went to a place which was like a no man's land mm-hmm. because of low rentals and opened a neighborhood speakeasy over there.
Mm-hmm. Fantastic. You've seen it all, right? You've worked behind the scenes, so you know how to even communicate with your staff. You know what goes behind the bar. I think what I'm trying to get to is because you've been able to work actual work, you can execute better, right? So let's go that direction because I really want to bring value to people who want to start a bar. Mm-hmm. You know, so what do you think is a criteria even before you start thinking? You can think of, you know, financial criteria. Let's say I'll give you an example of Delhi, so you have some framework. Mm-hmm. You know, in a decent area, what kind of leases, what kind of metrics it has to make sense. When do you think that you're really ready, even from the mindset, you know, that are you really ready for this five things? So give me that five things and then, okay, maybe now you can think of a bar, what really, you know, you are ready.
I think the first and the foremost is to have clarity of concept. That's very, very important. Okay. You know, before you even get into financials, before you even get into marketing and planning and programming, all of those things, I think the first and the foremost is definitely to have the clarity of concept, right? Once you have the clarity of concept, second important thing is to figure out if this is my concept, and this is the place or this is the city or the neighborhood that I want to create that concept, make that concept, will it fit into the scheme of things there? Do I have the right audience? Does mm-hmm. does that location complement mm-hmm. my concept? Very mm-hmm. important. The third important thing then is, if all of those two things kind of match, the third important thing is to then see if it fits into the scheme of things as far as the finances are concerned. So your rentals, right? Your overheads, all of those things then come into play. And after that, it's all about, you know, the right programming.
Okay,
and making sure that through your right programming, reaching out to the right audience.
Break that programming part. You mean like bar menu to the deco? What is programming?
Everything. It's a little bit of everything. This business, food and beverage, although we sell beverage and we sell food, but when you ask me what is the real product, I said it's everything. We sell everything, right from the lighting mm-hmm. to the chairs that you and I are sitting, how mm-hmm. comfortable the chairs are, mm-hmm. to the decor, mm-hmm. the look and feel, the space, the area. You know, you could have a small little cozy mm-hmm. place. You could also have a slightly bigger space. Mm-hmm. Everything comes into play, including your flooring, to how clean the toilets are, you know, your genre of music, the intensity of sound, does it kind of match with the profile of the bar and the people who are visiting you? Mm-hmm. All of these little things come into play because it's a sensory experience. You know, it is not just about drinking.
Correct.
It's not just about eating.
The smell, I can smell oranges.
Yeah, it's a sensory experience. Yeah. And what we usually do sometimes, you know, as we get towards the winters, we always make sure in both our bars, you'll see oranges and cinnamon.
Yeah.
Because it's that feel of winter,
true.
It's the feel of Christmas, right? You walk into a bar and you then order a mulled wine, you say, oh, I feel like having a mulled wine.
Yeah.
Right? So you need to make sure that it's a complete sensory experience.
I think what you're saying is amazing because that's where, I think you're a great marketer, by the way, I think, because
really?
Contextual marketing is the language which you're saying, mm-hmm. either it's digital or physical. Mm-hmm. And that's what you're trying to, I think, say that it has to be in the current context of things, mm-hmm. the deco, the place, the neighborhood, and all that has to play in place. Mm-hmm. I think I can already see, you know, personally, I can understand that you're a super business mind.
Really?
Let me ask you this, that do you know why your customers are coming here, assuming the fact that we're talking about that it's the early days, right? Now, obviously, half of them are coming because it's India's number one. It's becoming more of a checklist to do, you know, like a destination to go mm-hmm. if you're in Delhi. Mm-hmm. So before that, why do you think they were coming here?
Because there was no other bar which you could call a bar. So if you look at Delhi, there are a lot of bars.
Wow.
There are lots and lots of bars. But there are very few bars where you can go and have a conversation with the bartender, or where you could go with a friend, not to get drunk or to dance on the dance floor, but just there to catch up on things, right? You would go to a place where the music does not come in between you and your conversation, right?
Amazing,
you would go to a place where you can just, you know, you could come to this bar alone and you could just have a great evening. So it's purely on the lines of a good neighborhood bar.
Hmm.
It isn't a bar where you think of going only on a Friday, Saturday. This is a Monday, Tuesday bar.
Hmm.
So we do not focus only on a Friday and Saturday business. We always say, the guy should be able to come to a bar even on a Monday and Tuesday, right? So, you know, you finished work, you don't want to head home because, you know, you just want to get a glass of beer or a cocktail. You walk into Sidecar, right? You don't even think what you're wearing, whether you look good, do not look good, you look exhausted, nothing of that sort. You just walk into the bar because you feel like, oh, that's my place.
Yeah.
Right.
So, when you were developing Sidecar, you know, did you actually go to Hong Kong, London, you know, New York, and okay, I'm making notes, the lights are amazing here, I'm making notes, the music is good. It looks like, you know, because as you said, like if you are the best standard of India, that thought process would have come from somewhere. Mm-hmm. You know, how did that happen? How did you make this happen?
So I've been to a lot of bars in the US as well as in the UK, in Hong Kong, Singapore, but you know, 2017, so 2018 is when we opened, towards December is when we opened Sidecar, but 2017 I was in Edinburgh. And I would go to, and it isn't, of course, they have great bars, but it isn't amongst like the so well-known bars of London or New York, right? But
it's the neighborhood which you were looking
for. Yeah, but what I liked, and I went to a few bars there, is what I liked is, you know, it felt like happy bars, you know, you wanted to create a happy bar right from the outlook. So if you look at the facade outside, you will see it has a lot of resemblance of a typical Edinburgh kind of bars.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so I kind of really like that, you know, like from the outside only, it's this bar where you want to just go and get
Got
a pint.
Amazing. I think as a consumer, I would say, you know, I'm looking for a good vibe. So how do you create a good vibe, you know, if we had to give education on that part to people?
It's a very interesting question because there isn't a formula to create a great vibe. The important thing is you as a driver of the business, or you, somebody who is creating a bar. And I'll be very honest, when we walked into this place, I was traveling, my partners came, looked at the space. It was empty at that time. Nobody had occupied the space, and they sent me pictures. And they had said the space would not work because it has pillars in the center. So then my partner sent me the picture and said, there's one space over there, but we can't create a bar because it has pillars. My simple question is, what is the distance of the pillar from the wall? Then she said, that's about 12 feet. I said, yes, we can create a bar there, right? Because I know what I need from the wall, the distance is 7.5 feet. And after that, I can fit in one row of bar stools. And then when I came here physically, the first thing I think is I came in and visualized. And this is exactly what I had visualized. So I knew, okay, this will be the bar. It'll be against this wall, this long a bar. So the brief was very clear that I give to my interiors guy, right? So when you say vibe, I think it's all about you walk into a place and you yourself, as the promoter of the business, feel your imagination will work really well in this place. And then it's easy.
Got it.
But if you believe, or sorry, if you are confused yourself and you are so dependent on the interiors guy to give you the vibe, then it's a little difficult. That's where sometimes you may go wrong. So there's no formula for a good vibe.
Got it. It has to be your vision, end of the day.
I say this because I've been a bartender, right?
Yeah.
So when I make a cocktail, I do not know whether it's a great tasting cocktail or not. Yeah. I always know that it's a good tasting cocktail when I myself feel I made a good drink.
Yeah.
You know, so automatically the way I present the drink, the way the, you know, the creator of the drink himself is so happy with the drink that it sells easily, and automatically you would have a sip and say, wow, that's a good tasting drink.
Got it. Let's wear the bar owner's hat, right? Of you running multiple locations. What are the three most important things you would pay attention to? Obviously, there are 100 different things you'll have to do, like the soap is out of the bathroom to everything, right? It all is the owner's job. But what are the three things where you actually put your energy to make sure the top line is always taken care of?
When you say top line, you mean to say the financials?
Yeah, foot traffic, the numbers, the financials.
Yeah.
The business, I mean, the revenue.
So three things. So one is your F&B cost. You need to get that in place. You need to make sure that you get that right. So based on your budgets, your projection.
Okay.
Second is your payout. So your fixed costs,
okay,
like your rentals. I always feel for a F&B space, based on what your projections are, your rentals should not go between 10 to 12%.
But that's like one time thing, right?
Yeah.
You've signed a lease. What I'm saying is every week you want to know these three numbers, and you're navigating your business by making sure that these three things you are controlling properly. One is F&B cost for sure. It can come on a weekly thing. But the lease is already done, right?
Yeah.
But what about other stuff like HR issues?
No, more than the HR issues, I think it's also your marketing budget, you know, because you need to promote the place. You need to do something or the other. And I spoke about programming earlier on.
Got it.
Right? And that is a cost that you incur. So it comes from the marketing budget.
Got
it. So I know that this is going to be my marketing.
So you are involved personally in marketing as well?
No, my partner does most of that.
Understood.
I mostly take care of operations and I only kind of not even sign the check. My partner does most of that.
Got
but
it.
What I usually do is I do give inputs because, you know, based on what the season is like, if you need to do some kind of promotions, whether it's getting a band, genre of music, whether it is doing some things, whether it's getting like a bartender who could come and do a guest shift for us. So all of those things are part of the programming.
Understood.
But there is a budget for it. And that spend should not, you know, there is a certain allocation of that budget. More than weekly, we try to do it monthly because it kind of works well. You plan. That's very important because when we look at the spend, we look at the gains from that spend in many ways. Right? One is, am I doing this as an activity to just create that buzz around the market, or am I doing this to get returns out of it or financial returns? Am I driving in more consumers in here, or am I just building a good brand name?
Understood.
So we divide in the two sections. There are some activities that we do where it's pure gain.
Correct.
So it's okay, we do this activity, you get more customers on that particular day.
And what is that activity?
So when we do a particular type of music, we get a celebrity musician.
Okay.
He or she has a strong fan following, and we know that we'll do it on a Friday night or a Saturday night.
Got it.
Like what we do for a Christmas Eve or a New Year's Eve, right? So the idea is to make sure that the numbers are high as compared to the rest of the days. But then there are other activities, like what we did last week, for example. Got an international bartender Mm-hmm. Did a guest shift here, but that was not about pure gains. It was also about to build a reputation.
Correct, to build your brand.
Yeah, we are honest to what we're doing in terms of a product.
Yeah.
And to make sure that the trust factor is really high as far as the consumers are concerned. We are people who are serious about the drinks and the experience that we create for customers.
Have you raised your prices in the last 2 years? Let's say approximately, I want to go somewhere. How do you become more premiumization slowly? Apart from the, you know, how, at what time you think it's time to raise prices that you've earned it?
I think that is more to do with, you know, as we progress, you know, when you, there isn't a standard formula for that, but
not just for profit, I'm saying, because now you've become the number
absolutely.
One, let's say you may want to align the crowd which comes here.
No, I think, you know, pricing is not really one of the big factors, because what happens with pricing is, you know, there are, you know, especially in a city like Delhi, I don't think pricing
money
is
a
such
problem.
A problem. What is important is to be able to, like you mentioned earlier on, like the vibe, the right, you know, when you create an ambience or an atmosphere, which kind of works well for you, so then you would come here, right? But if you came here accidentally because, oh, it's, you know, Asia's 16th bar or world's 47th bar, and therefore I need to go and visit the place, you might come here, but you might not be the right audience. So you will still come here because you've heard about it, but it, and you know, you are somebody who can afford whatever expensive the drink is, but it might not be your kind of place, so you will never come back, right? So I think more than the pricing, as far as the filtration of the crowd is concerned, it's all about what you create.
Understood.
Right? So I think
what are you known for? Like what
absolutely.
Concept you're known for,
absolutely.
Sort of thing?
So, you know, you don't think of us when you think of going out partying. When you think of going out partying on a Saturday night, Friday night, you know, hit the floor, drink shots, you might not think of us.
So when you're doing your concept phase, do you write like, okay, name idea, sidecar, brief, here's what I think of a concept should be. Have you know, like it should be a...
Totally.
Yeah?
Totally, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So we do a mood board.
What is it?
A mood board for our bar.
Interesting. Could you elaborate, please, that?
So, you know, I'll give you a simple example. In our first bar, because we were not experienced running a bar, it was just bartenders, two of us getting together and said, we had that imagination in our head, but we didn't have a presentation for it. So when the interior, the architect guy, nice guy, young fellow, just come back from the US, done his design course there. And he said, what is it that you guys want to create? And we told him, have you heard this song by Toby Keith called I Love This Bar? And he said, no. I said, listen to that song, lyrics, and we'll talk tomorrow. Because it talks about this bar where, you know, everybody could just be there. You know, you do not know who you're meeting at that bar. It could be, you know, drunkards, it could be loafers, it could be all kinds of people, you know, right from engineers to, you know, businessmen.
Mm-hmm.
But it's my kind of a bar, you know, and so that was our brief, right? But when we do concert, like when we did Sidecar, we very clear. We chose the name Sidecar because we've used the cocktail Sidecar, which is a classic cocktail, as the muse for this bar. And we said, look, cocktail of the 1930s, so definitely the bar has to have a feel of 1930s. It's a very classic old school bar, but a very modern take in terms of the drink's philosophy. So these things were very, very clear. And to be more precise, it is purely a bartender's bar. So, you know, how is a bartender's bar different from any other bar that exists in town? Right, so the bar is the hero.
Got it. What about the cultural differences? Sometimes I can imagine, this is just my one guy's perspective, is let's say in London versus India, you know, sometimes bartenders are not given that respect. You know, it's more like a staff, more like, you know, hospitality staff. Mm-hmm. It's still getting there where, you know, I want to start opening up my private thing or a chat like, oh, my work was shit and whatever, right? So I don't think there is that people that stay there. What's your take on that? Like, are people actually engaging with bartenders the way they start engage there?
I think in the last 5-7 years, things have changed to a large extent, especially in cities like Delhi, Mumbai, Bangalore, you know, Pune, Goa. I think things have changed a lot. You know, the younger Indian audience is more experimental. The younger Indian audience is more exposed. The younger Indian audience is not just about money. I think they are okay to go to a bar, make friends with the bartender.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, and if the bartender is good enough, he's a true professional, there's a lot of respect for him.
Mm-hmm.
So I think there is a drastic change and a good change amongst the consumers as well.
Got it.
Right? Because I think it's more so because they've traveled a lot, they've experienced some great food and beverage across the globe.
Yeah.
And they know that when you go to a bar like this, and then, you know, you meet a professional bartender, you know that he is an artist at work. He is a professional. I need to give that due respect. So, you know, people have changed to a large extent.
Correct.
So now in most bars like ours across some of these major cities, I think there is a lot of respect for bartenders.
Nice, nice. That brings me to ask you, define a good bartender. Who's a good bartender to you?
A good human being. You have to have all the qualities of being a good human. Mm-hmm. What does that mean? You know, and I always, you know, kind of speak about this particular philosophy to all my bartenders, because you might learn about the drinks, the techniques, the recipes when you start working. That's on the job. But I cannot teach you how to smile. I will never be able to. I might say please smile, but I cannot put that smile into you.
Correct.
Right. And therefore, it has to come from within. The moment it starts to come from within, you will be, you know, a better bartender.
How do you gauge that in an interview?
I never ask technical questions when I interview bartenders.
I'm sorry, we'll come back to that, but you were answering and define a good man.
Yeah,
sorry to interrupt.
So, so when I say good human beings or good human qualities, it's all about this, right? When you meet a person, you should be happy meeting a customer. You should be happy for the
They should like customers, absolutely. I mean, end of the day. It's and people's business, right?
Absolutely. And then you need to be open to learning, right? So a customer comes in, you meet people from all walks of life.
Yeah.
It is not just about me giving them a drink. Sometimes the customer teaches you how to make a cocktail.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Right? Because you had that experience somewhere else. So it's a two-way thing,
yeah.
Right? And it's so much got to do with the human dealing that you have to have the right human qualities for sure. If you have that in place and then you enjoy what you're doing, I think everything else will happen over a period of time. Mm-hmm. You will gain great knowledge, you will learn the techniques, you will be able to bartend really, really, you know, at a great speed, make profit for you. All of those things will follow, but you will also be a greater bartender.
Got it. Yeah. I mean, I think it's very rare, like you are the boss and you are that personality which you just described, right? Okay. Where I can imagine that you are a happy person and a good person. So obviously your team can look forward to working with you, and you will attract that sort of talent naturally as well. Because if someone's staying for 2 years, I'm sure they're similar. It's like if my friends will be like mine, you know, end of the day, what I am.
Exactly.
So it will end up like that. So, but most of the bosses and multinational chains are like management, and they don't give a, it's all about P&L. And so how do they embrace a good culture? You know, what do you do in embracing, let's say, you were hired as a manager?
Yeah, I think I mentioned the word bartender's bar. That's the difference between any other bar and a bartender's bar, right?
Okay.
So even when you talk about a restaurant and a restaurant driven by a chef, that would be different. Right? A restaurant driven by a chef would more be, it would be driven by the chef's passion.
Got it.
In terms of the managers and the management, that is exactly what we talk about. You know, we definitely want to give, so we want to recognize the guys who are behind the bar on the floor taking care of the guests. We want to definitely make sure that they are the heroes of the place. Everything else is hardware. I cannot change the bar counter once it's made. I cannot change the lighting once it's done. I cannot change the decor of the place once it's done. But it's the human beings who
are working. Now it's on this five people to...
They can make a difference.
Correct.
Like, otherwise, why would a... Probably a person would come here first time thinking, oh, that's a beautiful looking bar.
Yeah.
He might say, oh, the music is great in that bar. He might come here for the first time because of the music or because somebody told him, oh, you go to Sidecar.
Yeah.
But from there onwards, for him to come back again, it is purely about the human dealing.
Correct.
It is the servers, it is the bartenders, the managers, all of us who take care of our guests. If we are able to lend that experience to them, a collective experience, they would definitely would come back here because they then feel, oh, I love going there because people are great, you know, they're always smiling, they seem to be positive, they seem to be nice and warm, and therefore I feel good going there.
It's a very selfish question I have, but let's say you're doing a team meeting, you know, what kind of things do you talk to, you know, in your weekly meetings to them, like guys, to motivate them to, you know, to help them smile, to help them go back to their work with a smile, you know, to help them feel satisfied at work. And I think it will help other bartenders which are struggling with overwork these days.
I always start, when we do team meetings, we had one yesterday, I always start by asking them questions in terms of where they are and what they feel about the place. You know, do they have some good things to say, some complaints, constraints that they are facing, or is it, you know, even relationship that they share with the colleagues? I always start by asking that question because, and then, people do come back to us and say, like, you know, I have this issue. Then I also say, okay, what do you think should be the right solution? So I leave it up to them. Reason being, I want each and every member to feel that very strong sense of belongingness to the place.
Correct.
It shouldn't be that I would be, or I have the solution for all of the issues. Because I always say that I spend lesser time than you guys do in this bar. You are the ones who are meeting the guests one-on-one. I'm meeting them, you know, maybe if there are 100 people coming, I'm only meeting 10 of them. Mm-hmm. But you guys are the ones who are taking care of them. So you guys know the problems, mm-hmm. and you might also have the solution for it because you guys are very much on the floor, mm-hmm. right? And I think that kind of really helps them to be able to connect to the place strongly. Mm-hmm. And anybody who is truly involved with operations, anybody who is truly involved with that particular issue, mm-hmm. will also have a solution to it, because you always think, oh, maybe if this was done in this way, mm-hmm. it would be better off, it would make me more comfortable. Mm-hmm. And I think that is exactly where the solution would start from. And then mm-hmm. we say, okay, let's take that point and let's see if it makes sense. Mm-hmm. So it should not be a one-way traffic, you know. Mm-hmm. Meetings, communication meetings should not be what the management is telling the mm-hmm. staff to do. I think it mm-hmm. should be more of an interactive session mm-hmm. where we would put in suggestion, do a little bit of a brainstorming and come out with solutions. Mm-hmm. So it's a fairly nice long bar, you know, and when you look the cross section of this place, it covers almost every nook and corner. So the whole idea of creating such a long bar was because I mentioned earlier about being a bartender's bar. And when I say that and making bar as the hero, because when you have a nice long bar like this, every customer sitting wherever mm-hmm. across this floor mm-hmm. has a direct connect with the bar. So you know exactly what's going on. So it gives you that feel of sitting at a bar, not at a restaurant, right? So that's the first thing. Now, technically, we've divided this into three stations. We have mm-hmm. three cocktail stations. So three professional bartenders can work. So each of this is a cocktail station. So we have all of the mixers that mm-hmm. is there in front, the ice bin, the sink, mm-hmm. and then all of the mixers that is required on each of the stations. So there's a garbage bin, there's ice, you know, chest. Mm-hmm. So these are three cocktail stations. And then we have the back bar. Now the back bar is divided into three sections. So on this side is where we have a lot of the, you know, darker spirits, but lesser known darker spirits. So you would see a lot of bourbon whiskeys, you would see some, you know, single malts, you would see a few wines, and you would also see a few liqueurs, right? In the center, we have mostly scotches. Right. Ideally, even on this one, we had scotches, but now that we're 3 years old and got quite a few awards that you'd like to show off, we've put them here. But otherwise, you will see mostly single malts and blended scotch whiskies over here, because that is what the Indians love. And that is what is very popular with most of our guests. So therefore, we have them stocked amongst the two shelves. And on this side of the bar is where you see mostly the lighter spirits. So here we have the vodkas and the gins and the lighter rums, some tequila, mezcal, if there is any. So all of that happens on this side. This mm-hmm. is the lighter spirit counter. And the reason why it is divided into three forms is because as a bartender, when I'm working over here and somebody orders, like, let's say a single malt whiskey, mm-hmm. he knows exactly where it is placed. So the back bar has to be set in this fashion all the time. Mm-hmm. And if there's any kind of a change that takes place, mm-hmm. it is purely with the consent of all the bartenders, because otherwise, you know, I might just change something over here, the other bartender might be looking for it, he'll get completely lost. So the back bar and the front bar is always set in this manner. Then of course the glasses of various types that mm-hmm. we keep right over here above the chiller.
And it's matching to the sort of drinks they would ask? No,
more than that, this is like, you know, you're working in the front, it's easy to just pull a glass. So whenever there is a drinks order, the first thing you do is take your glass and place it there, right?
Okay.
So it's easy to pull a glass from behind. Also, it gives more space for your mm-hmm. setup in the mm-hmm. front. There are some bars where, you know, you don't have the back bar space like this, mm-hmm. so you do not know where to stock your glassware. Mm-hmm. So you suddenly have glasses stacked in the center of the bar. Mm-hmm. You know, so with each station, there are glass stacked next to it. Mm-hmm. That's because you do not have space at the back, or you do not have a glass hanger.
Okay.
So that's when all of your glasses come with the working station. Over here, what we try to do is, we try to keep our workstation free mm-hmm. in terms of space so that you can have more stuff there, whether it's liqueurs, whether it's mixers, all of that equipments. And then the glass takes the back seat, you know, mm-hmm. it's right behind you mm-hmm. on top of the chiller. So this is a very classic style setup of a bar. Mm-hmm. You know, again, the size of the bar will also matter in terms of the number of covers that I have.
Correct.
And the size
I was
of the space.
About to ask you. So there's three stations are there. What is the maximum people you can serve in your
so
capacity?
So with this station, on a good day, you can easily serve 100 cocktail drinking audience. I'm talking about a
per station.
No, the three stations three together. I'm talking about a cocktail drinking audience, which means every time you make a cocktail, you're consuming more time, right? Mm-hmm. It's not a beer bar, it's a cocktail bar. So you know, people order drinks, so it takes a little time. We also do a lot of customized cocktails, so it takes a little bit more time.
Got it.
And the bar is based on that fact that, okay, if I have 100 covers here, I should be able to cater to all of them 100. If all 100 decide to drink cocktails,
correct,
I should be able to cater to them. Right. Had it been beer or straight drinks like whiskeys or vodka tonic, then it would be much easier. You could cater to that with just two stations, half the size of this bar. But because it's a cocktail
bar. And all three of your bartenders should know how to make cocktails?
Exactly. So like I said, these are three cocktail stations. So each cocktail station can produce all of the cocktails from the menu.
Got it.
As well as the
That's the way you set up. Like it's exactly three things.
Absolutely. It's just a replica of
And what about the flow? Let's say this customer, what about the money? He has to go and bring a bill himself, or he... Someone else is running around. Bar runs you have?
So the at the bar counter, you have about 12 to 14 stools.
Okay.
Amongst all the bar counter guests, you manage, amongst the three bartenders, you manage. So sometimes, because this particular bartender is also taking care of the floor
side,
order, and that bartender on that side is taking care of the floor order from that side, the guy who's in the middle is actually only taking care of the guest in the bar counter.
Correct.
So he's relatively, you know, less stressed in terms of what he's catering to. So therefore, he will make sure that he's taking care of all the checks.
How do you know just from the visuals that some, hey guys, things are not going right, right? Like what do they do that means let's go back to our things and...
You know, because I come with a lot of experience with the bar, even when I'm standing on the other side from a distance, I look at the bartender. The moment I feel he's uncomfortable is when I feel the bar is not right.
Yeah.
So then I walk in and I always
something's out, or
I always look at the ice, I always look at the mixers, I always look at the glassware and see where does it need my support.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes there are too many orders coming. He might not be able to, you know, dispense all of the orders at times. So I go and look at the order tickets and I say, okay, which are the things that you want me to dispense? So I pick up the order ticket from there, come to the center and help him out. So the help that I extend to the bartender is not just going and fixing a drink, it could be helping him with more glassware, helping him with providing the right ice or the mixers, or maybe cutting the garnishes for him, or just selecting the right glass, or just shaking all of the drinks that he's put the mixers on. So the first thing that I notice is the body language. The moment the bartender is uncomfortable, you know there is something wrong.
Very important. Great point. Let's go on a little bit of science behind this, right? So obviously I assume that whiskey is your number one category with sales here, so that's why you put it there, I guess. That's what, right? And maybe gin is something which you want people to... So that will be your slowest category. Am I correct? I guess?
Yeah.
If it's placed there.
That's the slowest.
And what changes, let's say, a tactical questions. If I literally said, you know, all right, you know, let's grow 20% sales this month. What changes would you do here in this setup which will result in actual efficiency?
What we will then do is we will try to, you know, more than that change, because it's a cocktail bar, you know, it's not a straight drink bar. So this may not change so much, but the front may change a lot.
Okay.
So in terms of the prep, so what we might then do is, I mentioned this earlier on as well, you know, it's a cocktail bar, it takes time. So every time you spend, every time there's an order of a cocktail, the more time that you spend in making the drink, you're losing on your time to sell a drink. But if you can quickly dispense the drink, you make more money. Right, because bar business is
usually... I finally now know why cocktails are expensive. It's the time.
No, it's the time. And so therefore, your preparation have to be correct.
Got it.
So there are bars which kind of collapse in between when it gets busy.
Yeah.
And you might have a big bar, but you might just collapse and your service might slow down.
Yeah.
The moment your bar service slows down, you're losing on revenue.
Got it.
So what we try to do is when we know that, okay, our focus is going to be quick sales, especially on Fridays and Saturdays, our prep is so good that it's a two-step process.
Okay.
So what we do is every time there's an order of a cocktail, it's a two-step process. So a cocktail that would otherwise take 3 minutes will only take 30 seconds. Right. So which means I'm being able to take out six cocktails in 3 minutes, which would otherwise be the time for one cocktail dispensing. So I'm saving on time.
Got
because
it.
The bar business is purely about
number
quick
of
service.
Yeah.
And it's only a handful of hours.
Correct.
And the difference of bar operations are very simple. At a restaurant, if you have 100 covers, you only have 100 guests because everybody likes to be seated when they're eating.
Got it.
But at a bar, if you're a 100 cover bar, you might have 125 guests.
Yeah.
Because people are okay just floating around at the bar.
Yeah. And sometimes you may lose actual customers because they're just lying.
Exactly. You know, because the moment somebody has to wait for a drink too long,
I finally convinced Sally to come and have a wine, and then I lost Sally because of the line.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So, so therefore, we try to emphasize on the fact that your prep is great.
Got it.
And all of your drinks are a two-step process.
on here, right, you said about the mood and the, you know, what kind of, like, walk me over some experiences which you remember, which, you know, are funny or a memory, you know, which you think, or maybe a good hustle, you know, like, just give us some case studies here where you think, wow, that bartender did an amazing job, or that customer just ordered that 1800 cocktail just because he or she fell in love with the bartender. Like, any examples that come in mind, like, it was a pure bartender execution?
So I think this happened just before the first COVID lockdown. I think this was towards the end of 2019, early 2020. I don't remember the exact time, but this was definitely a Saturday night. And two gentlemen walked in around, I think, about 12 o'clock. And then
In the night.
By one, we shut the bar. But they were in a great mood because the band was performing, and the band was probably doing the last set. So the intensity of the song was, you know, it's like great energy at the bar at that point in time. So he walks up and he orders a gin and tonic, and I'm looking at the guest, two of them order a gin and tonic, and he says, I would like to have a premium gin. So he looks at more of the most expensive gin, and he gets a gin and tonic, and then, you know, the atmosphere is great. And then what I liked about the bartender is he was very interactive. Says, can I twist a gin and tonic? And twists his gin and tonic. He uses, you know, I think he took a grapefruit or something and did a gin and tonic, made it look really nice and beautiful. And then I think he started chatting. The guest started to talk to him. And then by the time he finished the gin and tonic, he said, why don't you do a short, round of shots? You look in a great mood. And he went on to do the shots. Interestingly, instead of just doing the shots amongst the two, he said, can I buy shots for everybody at the bar?
Wow.
He said, yeah, sure. So he purchased shots for everybody at the bar, and his billing within a span of half an hour was 45,000 rupees INR
Delhi.
For two guests. Two guests. Now that is quick.
Yeah, yeah.
That is quick money within a span of half an hour for two guests.
Wow.
Great APC.
Yeah.
And that is purely because of great presence of mind of the bartender. I think if the bartender could just serve him a gin and tonic, not even check.
And the key here is you're at the end almost. Still, he did that.
No,
at like 12.
What I think that the bartender realized is that, you know, like I said, it was a Saturday night, the band was performing the last set, the energy is really, really high, the guy's walked in, he's picked up the most premium gin, and he's ready to do shots, and then just little things, and would you care for a shot? And he was, you know, it came from him. He said,
got
like,
it.
Can I buy shots for everybody else?
Nice.
I said, sure, you can.
Do you, like, incentivize your bartenders to drive sales, or is there anything, or it's purely non-pressure sales environment?
So it isn't a very sales driven bar. What we focus on mostly is, you know, I'll tell you, as a hotelier,
we used
to have this session where we were trained by the learning and development. We used to always go and attend a session which was purely about selling and upselling skills.
Correct.
And I was always against upselling skills. I would always say there is nothing called upselling skills in the food and beverage business. I would always say suggestive selling is a better way of putting it forward. So I'm not saying rip him off, because if the customer feels that, okay, I had a great time today, or, you know, he pays your bill and the next morning when he wakes up and looks at the bill and says,
true,
you know, that bar was really expensive.
I've had that feeling. Yeah.
And that's sad.
But oh my God, it was an expensive.
So the focus that we lend and the focus that
that's
we always tell our employees to figure out is, you know, when the guest wakes up the next morning and looks at the bill, he should say, wow.
Yeah.
He should not even care the figures. He should just say, wow,
great
what a night I had.
You're right.
Right. And that is more important. So so when you asked me that question earlier on in terms of the pricing and how you increase the pricing, and I didn't really was very comfortable answering that question, is because to me, I always felt that I would not want to price my drink at a premium. I would rather want an experience to be given to the guest.
Got it.
So instead of one, you have two. The amount of money that I made would still be more than what I would have done with just one drink.
True.
Like, you can come to my bar and you can buy a drink that's averagely priced, but the drink and the experience is so good that you say, let me get another one, right? So in totality, the amount of spend is higher than my beverage costs to the profit ratio.
What are the three biggest challenges you as a bar owner find on your weekly things, and how do you tackle that?
So one of the biggest challenges is running a bar in India itself is a challenge.
Okay.
So,
give me an example of India and London. What are the differences, for example?
No, there are a lot of other issues, you know, because for example, in Delhi, there's been a revise in the excise policy. So we were paying almost about 11 lakhs for a year.
Meaning a lot of compliance, paperwork.
Exactly. Licensing is a big thing.
Got it.
Right? Every year you got to renew your licenses, which means you go through the same process.
Is it every year?
Every year. and then you go through this almost the same process.
My,
You know, so what happens also at times is, you know, for example, the new policy, you're paying double the fees this year onwards as compared to last year. So instead of a 10% or a 20% hike, it's just double. So if you're paying 50 rupees last year, you're paying 100 bucks. Now that takes up your cost, and certainly you cannot double the price of a cocktail or your drink, right? And you got to also make sure that you retain your stuff. So all of those things are big challenges, which I think the system does not really understand. And that is where I think it becomes a little difficult for all of us in the business of
it boss. Tests you, right? Your patience. One last question and then we'll wrap. Sure. You know, what's something that you would want to tell young bartenders, you know, someone who's trying to grow and who's really passionate to grow their career? Mm-hmm. You know, anything that you would want to say in the camera just for the young bartenders out there?
So this is something that I keep saying to all amateur bartenders or young bartenders or the bartenders of the future. I always say, very important, you have to think big. So you need to dream big, think big, and work towards your goal, your vision. When you do that, the one thing that you need to keep in mind is there's nothing called shortcuts. So never ever try to take shortcuts in life, because it really makes a weak foundation. So if you have a weak foundation, you will always struggle in the later part of your career. So the idea is to make a strong foundation, have a big dream or a big ambition, but no shortcuts. We'll be right back.